Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. On today's program, comedian and character actor Fred Stoller stops by. You recognize him from all your favorite sitcoms. His new book is a bestseller. It's called Maybe We'll Have You Back, The Life of a Perennial TV Guest Star. He joins the director of An Unreasonable Man, comedy writer Steve Skrovan, as we recall the L.A. riots back in 1992. Also, law professor Jody Armour, one of the leading experts on race and how it intersects with our criminal justice system, returns to this program with some unkind words for comedian Chris Rock. Then we talk about some of the myths of Halloween with Mark Thompson, Will Ryan, and our producer Alicia Cordova, and of course, new music from Will Ryan and the Cactus County Cowboys. All that and much more right after this.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Hello, I'm board-certified plastic surgeon Dr. Paulie Lafontaine, and my patented laser collagen dermabrasic system has been keeping Brentwood looking young for, let's say, 29 years. I can make even the most sun-baked Brentwood housewife look like she's 18 all over again. But you don't have to take my word for it. Just look at the difference. All right, you can't actually see the difference, but take my word for it. Before I got a hold of her, this woman looked like Chris Brown's last blind date. Anywho, whether you need a new rack or your nose is all jacked up, come see me, Dr. Paulie Lafontaine, located conveniently on Beverly Glen above 4-star flooring. I'll fix your face.
Call 1-800-SMELL-OK.
Who the f*** was that?
Call 1-800-SMELL-OK.
The f*** are you talking about?
Call 1-800-SMELL-OK.
You know where to find me.
Call 1-800-SMELL-OK.
The call's coming from inside the house.
That's 1-800-SMELL-OK.
I was in the back seat the whole time.
1-800-SMELL-OK.
In a former life, they called me the hammer.
That's 1-800-SMELL-OK.
I don't use phones. Too many options.
And 1-800-SMELL-OK.
I do all my work with an ice pick, because I can.
At 1-800-SMELL-OK.
Are you a cop? You gotta tell me if you're a cop.
At 1-800-SMELL-OK.
Here, hide this in there.
At 1-800-SMELL-OK.
And now, with the latest in Southland traffic, we take you up to the Pacificopter and our eye in the sky, Swede Peterson.
He served our country in Vietnam, Swede Peterson.
That's me.
Your eye in the sky.
Swede, how's it looking out there?
We're flying over Sherman Oaks right now, where the rush hour traffic is unusually light. People are making great time, especially my former best friend, Ted, who's making time with my ex-wife, Mei Ling, in the parking lot at the Fashion Square Mall.
Swede, that's great news for people getting a jump start on that weekend getaway. What's making things so easy?
The fact that she's not even playing hard to get. If I ever tried that with my tongue, Mei Ling would have called the cops. But apparently Ted's taking the express lane up her Ho Chi Minh Trail, while I have a bird's eye view in this friggin' chopper. We're going in closer now so I can dump this tub of live rats on them. Hey, Ted, I call this one Operation I Hope You Get the Plague.
Swede, as we go into our afternoon drive, will things get tougher down there?
I don't know. What do you think, Feldman for Brains? Do you think watching my war buddy hump my wife is going to get easier? Mei Ling, my herbal tea, my dragon puppet, made up of a bunch of guys in a costume. It's not too late for our love. And Ted, I hope you choke on an orange Julius at the food court, you prick. Also, 3-car collision at Woodman and Burbank. Look for alternate routes.
Thanks, Swede Peterson from the Pacific Opera of the Sky.
He served our country in Vietnam, Swede Peterson.
That's me.
Your eye in the sky.
Jody David Armour is the Roy P. Crocker Professor of Law at the University of Southern California, USC, and one of the leading authorities on race and how it intersects with our criminal justice system. Thank you for joining us, Professor.
It's a pleasure to be here, David.
What is the name of your blog?
Yes, well, my Twitter account is Nigga Theory, and the reason I call the...
I just have to say up front,
I have a problem, as you know, with the word theory. I find it highly offensive.
Well, on this occasion, the theory part is trying to find a way to reconcile us with, as Americans, with the people that we have categorized, classified, and condemned as niggas. And when Chris Rock says in one of his famous routines, "I love black people, but I hate niggas," and defines niggas as black people who committed crimes, then what he's saying is 90% of the black community in some inner city neighborhoods where young black men, up to 90% of which, wind up in jail on probation, on parole at some point in their lives, he's talking about them. He's calling staggering numbers of our young black males trapped in poverty niggas. What I want to do is reclaim them. I want to break down the moral barriers, the judicial barriers, the social barriers between criminals and non-criminals in the black community to start with, and then more generally, because these criminals that Chris Rock is taking shots at, and Randy Kennedy at Harvard Law School said similar kinds of things about good Negroes versus bad Negroes. What they're getting at, and a lot of times, is they're really getting at poor black males, because the crime rate between the middle class whites and middle class blacks is indistinguishable. They're almost identical.
Very interesting, because Chris Rock's career really was made on that routine.
Yes.
And it struck a great big nerve in the white community.
Yes.
And it let a lot of us off the hook, where you found yourself saying, you know what, I'm not a racist. I just hate certain types of black people. And I have every right to hate certain types of black people. So are you suggesting that that routine gives white people and black people permission to discriminate against, you're saying, 90% of the black community?
In some inner city neighborhoods, up to 90% of the young black males will wind up in jail, on probation, on parole at some point in their lives. By his definition, 90% of them are niggas. And you're right. It does let a lot of white and black middle class, especially, people off the hook, because most of the crime is being committed by poor people, specifically poor blacks that I'm talking about right now in those 90% figures. So what you have is a lot of middle class blacks wagging their fingers and talking down to their poor brothers and sisters trapped behind ghetto walls. And as you point out, justifying white folks' kind of stereotypes and perhaps hypersensitivities along the way.
Right. It's almost, well, it is worse than he's one of the good ones.
Absolutely.
It used to be there was a subtle pejorative of he's one of the good ones. Now it's there are blacks and there are, you know what, I just won't say the word, because once I start saying it, I won't stop, Professor.
Well, I hear you. And it ties into something deep, David. And what it's tying into is the whole personal responsibility canard that's been pushed by the right and many on the left have bought too. You watch Bill O'Reilly, it's personal responsibility from the beginning to the end and all the way in between. That's their shibboleth. And now you hear people like President Obama wagging his finger at Morehouse graduates and a lot of other blacks when he has to speak before black audience on black issues. And he's always talking about personal responsibility, staying at home, you know, being a father in the house and all of that. He didn't have a father in the house and he became president. But somehow he's going to trace all the black community's problems to not having a father in the house or not practicing personal responsibility, rather than saying, hey, if I don't have a job, I'm coming from a crumbling school, I don't have any options. Maybe crime is the only rational choice.
I read a statistic, I think 40% of black families are single parent.
Yeah.
I suspect that's a function of economics. I know that when money is tight in our house, my wife and I go at it because marriage is a business deal. It's a contract. That's why you enter into it. You pool your resources, economy of scale, sex. And when money's tight, you're angry at each other. So in a community that is oppressed, where money is tight, having the father stay and be angry and abusive is not good.
And he may be a liability as well financially beyond that, in that the government structures some of its relief programs in such a way that if there's a male in the house, you lose the relief. So, you know, you're not even going to get relief from your hunger or basic utilities paid if he stays there without a job. And you know how high the unemployment rate is. So if he can't find a job quick, then you're going to lose any kind of support you have just because he's around.
Breaking news, Paul Dooley at the anchor desk. It is day 21, and we're on the Wachtell Watch, where USA Network veteran Jeff Wachtell holds the newly created position of President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment. For more on this ongoing story, let's go to our reporter, Hal Lublin, outside NBC Universal's Burbank headquarters. Hal, any new developments?
Thank you, Paul. It is day 21, and we're on the Wachtell Watch. 3 weeks since Jeff Wachtell was named President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
Hal, to confirm what I just heard from you, Jeff Wachtell is still, after 3 weeks, that's 21 days for you at home, in the newly created position of President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
That's correct, Paul. Jeff Wachtell, after 21 days, or 3 weeks for those of you at home, is still in the newly created position of President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
That's what I thought you said. Hal, you know, as journalists, we have a sacred obligation to report the truth. Do you have confirmation on this?
Paul, on my phone is a selfie Wachtell took of himself in his office, sitting in his new $1,000 ergonomically correct office chair.
Well, thank you, Hal. It's Paul Dooley back in the newsroom. What's a selfie?
Great question, Paul.
Thank you, Hal. Great work. Stay safe. Now back to our 24-hour coverage of the riots in Koreatown.
Hey, how'd you like to buy a ukulele? It could really come in handy in a pinch. Oh, how'd you like to buy a ukulele? It ain't too hard to play because it's a cinch. You can pick a tune and start to strum, then simply croon or whistle or hum. Oh, how'd you like to buy a ukulele? You could take it with you everywhere you go. The museum or the zoo, Zanzibar, Timbuktu. How'd you like to buy? How'd you like to buy? How'd you like to go and buy yourself a ukulele?
This segment of the David Feldman Show is brought to you by the American Association of Independent Ukulele Manufacturers, who remind you that while the war is over, the musician strike is on. But never fear, in the official opinion of President Petrillo of the American Federation of Musicians, the ukulele is not a musical instrument. So have fun and play a ukulele today.
How'd you like to go and buy yourself a ukulele?
Earlier, Mark Thompson, Will Ryan, and our producer, Alicia Cordova, talked about some of the myths surrounding Halloween. Halloween is coming up. Have you picked your costumes? I'm going as a balding Jew with glasses.
That's great.
That's mine.
Nice pick. I'm going as a sexy nurse.
I'm going as Will Ryan.
Hey, me too.
So you're all going as sexy nurses. Now, when I was growing up, we were told that somebody was putting razor blades in apples. Alicia, you're young.
Yeah.
Did your mother and father go through your candy to make sure it wasn't laced with cyanide?
No, it was always like making sure none of the wrappers had been like punctured or
tampered with. Yeah.
When you were growing up, Mark.
Well, that was a legend. That was the. And
did
now
they have
that you
candy
said it,
when you were a kid?
Wow, wow.
We're the same age.
So the question stands.
Did they go through your candy?
I beg your pardon? Actually, it was legend. I mean, when I say legend, it was active legend, mythology, urban myth, that they were doing two things, putting razor blades in apples and also putting pins, I guess they said, in chewing gum or something.
Also, like, poison, just like in general, like poisoning candy.
Oh yeah, but my folks just my folks were passed out in the corner. They didn't really.
My mother. One of the reasons I'm such an a-hole is because of my mother, who decided that Halloween candy was not healthy and that people needed to eat nutritiously. One Halloween, she gave out apples.
And I said, Mother, people put razor blades in apples. She says, I don't care. People need to eat healthily. And, you know, apples are on sale at A&P, and I'm giving out apples. I said, you're crazy. Nobody's going to eat them. So we used to play street hockey when I was growing up, and we all put on our roller skates and got our hockey sticks. And I said, guys, let's go across the street and watch for about an hour as these kids come to my house and my mother hands out apples. And we watched for an hour. By the time my father came home from work, he was on the phone to get the house painted. That my mother gave out the, I swear to God, my mother gave out apples. And the kids waited till the door shut, and then they just threw the apples at the house. So the entire house was just covered with apples, and my dad was hosing it down when it came. They don't listen. So it turns out there is not a single case of tainted candy. Mm-hmm. Not one. Except for there is one case. Back in 1975, one guy.
He was trying to kill his own kid, right?
Yeah. How'd you know that?
Because I read.
She reads.
Oh.
It was when? 1975?
Yeah. That's the only example of somebody.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
That's a sweet way to kill your kid, though.
It's literally a sweet way to kill your
kid. It is. It's bittersweet. Like, you're killing me, Dad, but I'm getting
past the
Snickers,
Reese's.
Yeah.
That's not, you know.
The David Feldman Program is made possible by a generous grant from Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet of Redlands at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, restrooms.
Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, restrooms.
Hello, I'm Debbie DiPetro of Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet of Redlands.
And I'm Jimmy DiPetro, brother of Debbie DiPetro of Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet of Redlands. Can I have some candy?
No. October means Halloween, and Halloween means scary good sales here at Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet of Redlands. We're slashing prices on used and older model Chevrolets all month. Drive off in a 2012 Chevy Cruze for just $29.89.99.
And stop by the haunted house I set up on the lot. You'll ask yourself, is the dead rat I saw in that 1988 Chevy Celebrity real, or was it planted by Jimmy DiPetro or Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet of Redlands? I'll never tell. Can I have some candy?
Jimmy, you put dead rats in the used cars?
The live ones kept getting away. Plus, how else am I supposed to scare the customers? Dad already caught me in the courtesy lounge giving myself the monster mash.
Jimmy, we're not supposed to scare the customers.
Now you tell me. I spent $1,000 on animal waste just last night.
For the used cars?
As a conversation starter. Now can I have some candy?
No.
Then you left me no choice.
Jimmy, you just hit me in the face with a raw egg.
Trick or treat.
Jimmy, is it time for me to come out in this damn vampire costume yet?
I'm a monster!
Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet of Redlands, at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, spooky!
There's two Draculas! There's two! They always come in pairs! Help! Help! Debbie, help! My ghost costume just turned into Boom Boom City! Help! Quick! Help, please! Spammy ghost! Spammy!
Jerry DiPetro Chevrolet at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, restroom.
Hello, Southern New Jersey. This is Karl Kake, a beautiful bronze, a Matawan. Ladies, fall is busting out all over, and your bosoms need a proper brassiere to retain their spring. Introducing the Kake Nude Support Bra. It holds you snug while allowing that tantalizing jiggle that gets you noticed. I'm wearing one now. It's bra genius. This is Karl Kake of Beautiful Bras, reminding you to go beautiful or go bust.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Are you hearing me?
I'm not.
We're rolling.
All right.
No, good morning, everybody. Is the distortion gone?
Yeah, the distortion's gone.
I fixed it.
For the most part, yes.
Did you think I could do that, Fred Stoller?
It's freezing. Could you fix that?
I'll try to, sir. I really will, because you know that I'm thrilled you're here.
And we're doing this from a tent.
That's the voice of Steve Skrovan, the director of An Unreasonable Man. Speaking of unreasonable men.
Well, it's a segue.
No, Fred. No, not at all. I was going to introduce Will Ryan.
Oh.
Will, speaking of unreasonable men, have you ever met Fred Stoller?
Fred and I have known each other for decades.
I guess. Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
For 25 years?
I guess. But it doesn't help the stories that are not. Yeah, 92, I think, from Rena.
Yeah.
From what?
Some woman who I met her. Our first date was the curfew party for the LA riots, and they had a curfew party in her apartment complex in the hallway, and people.
That sounds romantic.
Yeah, it was good because
that's the title of the movie, Curfew Party.
And I
that's the screenplay.
They only have matinees. For the movie.
I had to spend the night because I wasn't allowed to leave, so that was my gimmick.
Hang on, hang on. All right, 1992, the Rodney King verdict came down.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And it was surreal that people think it was the rioting was the inner city on La Brea, the 7-Eleven and Sunset.
Well, hang on for one second. Why were they rioting? Set the stage, because this was 21 years ago.
So all the teen MTV viewers can learn now?
Rodney,
because the verdict they had on video of him getting beaten by cops with clubs.
Right.
And they got off. And
they were tried in Simi Valley.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. The cops are from Simi Valley. Even though it was, I forget where it took
place.
Why
did they move it to Simi Valley?
Because it's near the Reagan Library. And
yeah, why couldn't it have been in Los Angeles?
Because Los Angeles has black people and Simi Valley doesn't. So yeah. They didn't feel that the
black people would be prejudiced.
Yes,
see.
Right. But,
you know, you
that's
you,
true. That they did
yeah,
move it.
I know. Yeah.
You know what the biggest
they wanted a jury
they
of
wanted
their
a
peers,
fair trial.
A jury of their peers. So
the biggest injustice of that thing is not so much that they didn't get convicted, is Stacey Coon. Because he got fired, other cops raised like $10 million. You know, they all said, "Oh, we got to help out a fellow cop." Same thing with Zimmerman. Now, people raised money for him.
By the way,
and
that guy's a limo driver, Stacy. What's his last name?
Coon.
And he was the guy who beat up Rodney King.
Right. A lot of comedians say jokes.
That his first name was Stacy. I always.
I didn't. That's Stacy. An old one, but that I didn't see it going
those,
there.
Those are shoes that black people wear. The Stacy Adams. I was living in San Francisco at the time, and somebody called me and they said, the cop...
Fred has a chance of getting lucky.
Fred's getting lucky.
Because of the riots, he can't go home.
What were the odds of these cops getting off? If they got off, Fred's going to get off tonight. I remember some friends called me, can you believe that these cops got off? I could not believe it. And then I turn on the TV... And they were rioting, and I went, of course they're going to riot. Why would you not riot? So there was rioting in Los Angeles.
There were, like, tanks going down the street, every street. Were you here?
I was here. I don't remember tanks.
Did you see that? Well, you live in, like, La Crescenta.
Yeah,
but,
in Hollywood.
In Hollywood, there were tanks going down.
Literally,
the
army
National
tanks?
Guard. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. And like I said, they were scared it was going to go to Beverly Center. But I remember they looted the 7-Eleven on La Brea and Sunset. So it wasn't...
That's a tough 7-Eleven to loot because the guy behind the cash register says,
Are you going to loot or are you going to just stand there? Either loot or leave.
But I like that there was a curfew because there was not pressure to go out. You know what I mean? The curfew was a few nights. I like that everyone had to be doing what I do. I like that.
Everybody had to be in.
Yeah. So I like the fact that there was no, where do I go? What do I do?
You didn't have to think about that because you can't go anywhere. The curfew party was after.
There was a few nights. There was, I guess they were doing like, there was a gay guy walking. I lived in West Hollywood at the time going, curfew party, everybody. And he made a face. Okay, I'm left
also. We're on KPFK here. Okay. we don't make fun of.
I'm not making fun, but he screamed out curfew party. He was excited. They were excited in those courtyards that they were, you know, they had an excuse
well,
to
I mean,
party.
I'm just, they, who's they?
My neighbors.
And you're saying, what?
Not all people, but especially this one guy was excited.
But,
you know,
it doesn't matter what his sexuality
is. No, I was excited to go in, stay out. But I heard about a curfew party. So in Hollywood, you know, like, you know, they have those courtyards where, you know what I'm saying, there's like a little fountain and, mm-hmm. and people spill out. So Rena plays the banjo or the violin or what does she play? Something.
Banjo.
Yeah.
Rena.
Yeah, she's a woman.
Can we mention her
the
last
mutual
name?
Friend between Will and Fred.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you been paying attention to
I am. I'm trying to.
So there were a bunch. So
it's
this
complicated.
Is, this is
I
the
wasn't
thing.
A football player at Yale like
but
you,
this is
Skrovan.
The thing. So everyone got
stop
up.
Stop throwing it at my face.
So they all, one person got up, and I don't get drunk a lot, but I got drunk. So and so one person got, you know, does the guitar. Reno, I think, played the flute. So then
that's
some,
right. Oh, yeah. Yeah, because we used to play lute and flute.
Lute and flute, of course.
Together.
And they were looting that night.
That's right.
That was the whole theme, lute and flute.
So then, so this guy gets up. He goes, next, we have a guy. You just saw him on the HBO Young Comedian Special, Fred Stoller. I go, I'm going to walk home and take the risk of the National Guard shooting me in the head before I get up in the courtyard doing my low-key act. I said, I am not getting up there. Come on, everyone. They did the guitar. And I said, nope, nope.
And now, to help you get ready for the weekend, it's KPFK's Kitty Ainello with the exclusive Pacific Forecast.
Happy October, everyone. The leaves are turning colors, the air is brisk, and my Enzo Angiolini Scarly wide calf boots are working with my ASOS mini skirt to perfectly outline my legs and butt. This weekend will be the perfect weather to make some hot apple cider and do Kegel exercises by the fireplace. I'm into three ways, and tonight we'll see lows in the mid-60s.
That's Kitty Ainello with the Pacific Cast, only on Pacifica Radio, 90.7 FM. The Bone. The
Bone. Today's show also features Paul Dooley, Janie Haddad Tompkins, Jeremy S. Kramer, and Hal Lublin. And portions of the program have been written by David Weiss, Will Dixon, Hal Lublin, and David Feldman. The David Feldman Show is available as a podcast for free on iTunes. I invite you to friend me on Facebook, and please follow me on Twitter. If you're listening to this program as a podcast and would like to hear it broadcast, I ask you to contact your local public radio station and say, I want the David Feldman Show. Our executive producer is Troy Conrad. Our producer is Alicia Cordova. Don't forget to sign up for my free newsletter by going to davidfeldmanshow.com, where you will also find a treasure trove of podcasts and radio shows dating back to 2009. It's all free. Special thanks to Matt Perez, Stan, Tamika, Ali, Lexa, Jimmy Dore, and of course, Alan Minsky from the KPFK Studios in Southern California. I'm David Feldman. Thank you for joining us.